Okay, so I was supposed to take 45 minutes of combustion and 45 minutes of kinetic theory, and let's see how much I can finish. Okay, combustion is something that, you know, sometimes you will have to touch upon in thermodynamics, at least in basic thermodynamics, because it may, or it may be a part of what you would normally have with a cycles course. That is, if you are running a cycles course like applied thermodynamics or something, okay, you will need to teach some amount of combustion definitely, and I am covering only the basics here. And I think the real key thing that you need to first explain to students is that this is not, you know, really out of the way, and it is something that they need to know, just because when we run any cycle, especially power cycle, we use some fuel, and we need to know at least something very basic regarding the fuels that we are using, and this is why we need to know at least something about combustion. And these are very reasonably rudimentary stuff that we teach, and a lot of it is based upon 12th standard or 11th and 12th standard chemistry. So I think that is something that you must emphasize. So before you, you know, get into combustion, the a lot of times you need to tell them about fuels, and you know, this can need not be some detailed thing, because we are not doing, you know, detailed properties of fuel, but as long as you know, and this is something which is very common in knowledge to them, it just, you need to re-emphasize that fuels can be solids, liquids or gases. And typically what we would normally use in solid fuels is only coal. So if they are, of course, you know, going to do a further course on combustion, they would probably be interested in biomass and wood. But you know, you can tell them that this is what exists, and then you can tell that coal, of course, you know, they would have studied, you know, a reasonable amount of material sometime in maybe 10th standard or something about how coal is formed, you know, that wood gets into the below the ground and there is pressure and so on. But you can just tell them about various types of coal that exist. So for example, lignite, it's a word which people would have normally heard, and then, you know, anthracite or regular bituminous coal that is found in India. And you can emphasize that Indian coal is mostly, a big chunk of it is, has ash in it, and that is one of the reasons it's not so good for, you know, good metallurgical processes where you need really good coal which is made purely of carbon. Whereas if you have something which is, which has lot of ash or lot of residue, okay, it's a pretty good fuel for what we call as external combustion engine. I mean, that is, whatever you combust, that is not combusted in the working fluid. So that is, I mean, you will, of course, whenever you are teaching cycles and engines, you will teach what is external and internal combustion. And the most common example that you will give for an external combustion engine is the steam turbine, because the steam is the working fluid and the combustion is always outside, and whenever it is outside, you can use any fuel you want, because that is not going to contaminate your working fluid. So I mean, you can use coal, you can use oil, you can use gas, anything to heat the working fluid. Then, so you should emphasize that the most common solids that we look at are coal. Okay, and then you can say that as far as we are concerned, you know, the other engines that we will look at are mostly, you know, gas turbine cycles or automotive, you know, engine cycles, and these are going to be internal combustion engines. And if they are internal combustion engines, you know, you can't use a solid fuel there, and then you would rather use a liquid fuel. And you know, the regular internal combustion engines, which are automobile engines, will use either petrol and diesel. They can also use gas. Similarly, the gas turbines can also use petrol and diesel kind of, or liquid fuels, or they can use gas, because you can spray it, atomize it, and there will be very less residue. It will go over the moving part, maybe sometime here and there there will be some black carbon residue, but overall, you know, it will not spoil the working parts of the engine, and that is the key. So at this time, you know, and definitely sometime in 11th or 12th, somewhere they would have heard this word called fractional distillation. and they know, you can just re-emphasize that, you know, there is something called crude oil, which you basically bring from, you know, drill from below the ground, and this is the whole mixture of things, and you do what is called as distillation, that you warm it up and then start cooling it down in different temperatures, and depending on the molecular weight of the compound, you will, you know, get distills at different levels, and whatever doesn't really liquefy will be just purely gas, and anything which is gas at room temperature, you can say roughly hydrocarbons. See, most fuels that we will use will be okay. So most fuels that we'll use will be hydrocarbons, and you know, one thing you can point out to them mostly is that if I, let's say I take alkanes, which are the quite common hydrocarbons that they have already learnt in 11th and 12th, then the lower alkanes, that is methane with CH4 or ethane C2H6, okay, all the way till at least around C5, these are low molecular weight compounds, they will normally be in gaseous state at room temperature. So they won't liquefy at room temperature, whereas the moment you go to C6, C7, they will be in liquid form, and roughly you can tell them that petrol is formed of hydrocarbons which are between C6 and C10, and the most common compound or which is supposed to form a big chunk of petrol is what normally is called as isooctane, and this is something you can emphasize that roughly when someone says petrol, so petrol is you know, roughly C8 plus minus 2, then kerosene is roughly around C10, and diesel is more around C14. This is C10 to C12 roughly. So it gets heavier as you go from petrol to kerosene to diesel, and anything above that, you know, if people normally use as furnace oil, and they would not, its flowability is not that good, and that is what happens. And then of course, you can tell them that what occurs naturally in marshes and swamps is mostly composed of methane, okay, and if someone says natural gas, that means more or less 90% methane. That is, when people say compressed natural gas, that is more or less 90% methane or more than that. And if you have what is called as LPG, petroleum gas, that is a combination of propane and butane. So there is C3H8 and C4H10. So roughly, as I said, you know, you go up to C5, you have gases, beyond that it is liquids, and much beyond, you know, close to tar, which is like C50 or C60. Really, it is not flowing and more like gooey solid around there. So once you explain to this and where you use all of these, and that most of these are hydrocarbons, I think that will at least tell them that why some kind of knowledge about fuels is needed. So the next thing that we need to do is tell them that whatever chemistry we do, it is regular thing that they have seen earlier in 11th and 12th standard. So if they write an equation for, you know, solving, okay, CH4 plus O2 gives CO2 plus H2O, okay, then you should tell them that, okay, as with any other equation, this is CH4, let's say natural gas, okay, if you need to burn it, you will need to provide oxygen and you will form CO2 and H2O, but there are a few rules that need to be followed, and these are all things that they have studied in 11th and 12th standard. That is, you need to balance this reaction, okay. So balancing means two things are happening. One, each element should be equal on both sides. So you are not destroying elements. These are not nuclear fusion or fission type of reactions where some atom is splitting up, okay. So obviously, if there are 10 oxygens on this side, there should be 10 oxygens on the other side, nothing is disappearing, okay. If some oxygen is not burning, it will appear as unburnt oxygen on the right side. So that is something you can emphasize, that this is something that they already said. So each element is balanced, Okay, so that means I will need to balance this reaction, and hence, you know, by default, you know, mass is also balanced. Okay, again, this is not a nuclear reaction. There is no mass defect. No mass is getting converted into energy. Each element to element goes here. It carries the same mass on both sides. No mass is disappearing. Mass on both sides will remain the same. So you will just have to balance the reaction, and you will have to ensure that, you know, I will have to put x, y, a, b, and x, y, a, b should ensure that my carbon is equal on both sides, my hydrogen is equal on both sides, my oxygen is equal on both sides, or just O, I should say. I mean, this is standard stuff they should know. I mean, there is nothing new here, it is just a re-emphasis. The thing maybe you can emphasize is that, you know, moles will not get balanced. Okay, you may have 3 moles of this, 1 mole of this, 1 mole of this, 1 mole of this. So there may be 4 moles on the left side and 2 moles on the right side, and that will always happen. Okay, only you are going to balance elements and mass. Moles need not get balanced in a, because, you know, you are, what is basic is the atoms and the mass, not the moles. So moles need not get balanced. Okay, so once this part is done, then you know, this is all background emphasis. Then there is something else also they know normally, and which is called as Hess's law. Okay, and this is again something that you probably can tell them now from a new light, from the point of view of thermodynamics, that, you know, for every reaction there is something called, you know, in olden terms it was called the heat of reaction. Okay, so if I have a reaction which gives A plus B going to C plus D, then I add up the enthalpies of these, and I add up the enthalpies of this. Okay, and each compound, okay, at a particular pressure and temperature, you know, it's a state property. It's a compound. At this pressure and this temperature, it has its own enthalpy. You change the temperature and pressure, it will have a different enthalpy. So it's just a state property. Okay. So now, of course, you know, this two additions, they will, let's say I have calculated this at 1 atmosphere and some temperature which is 25 degrees C. Okay. If I really combust, the temperature changes, but what I am supposed to do is bring it back to the same temperature. So bring it back to atmosphere and 25 degrees. In this case, what happens is that some, you will realize that these two additions at this pressure and temperature will not add up to these two additions. Okay. So the net enthalpy of the reactants is not the same as the net enthalpy of the products at 1 atmosphere and 25 degrees C, and this is what is called as normal temperature and pressure. So what is happening is that if the products are at a lower enthalpy, it means you have actually released some amount of energy, which is what we use. So here is when you should probably emphasize that if I have something which is called a fuel, and if it has to burn with oxygen, then definitely the reaction that I am looking for should have the products at a lower enthalpy than the reactants, otherwise it is not a fuel. I mean, if the products turn out to be at a higher enthalpy, that means it is absorbing energy from the surroundings to get to wherever it is, then, you know, it is not a fuel, you are actually, you know, cooling down the environment, whereas what we really want is a release of energy so that you can, you know, use it to boil water or use it to heat the gas, etc. So fuel is something which necessarily, once it burns, you know, that is the property it better have, that, you know, at the end the product should have a lower enthalpy than the reactants. And then you define something called the heat of reaction, which is just enthalpy of the products minus the enthalpy of the reactant. And this is also something that people, for heat of reaction is a common term that people would have seen in 11th and 12th standard. Okay, it is not something new, maybe they would have forgotten it, but at least you can tell them what it means from the point of view of fuels. So this is something that you need to put in. And continuing with Hess's law, what people should know is that I can have A plus B here. Let's say I have A plus B on the enthalpy scale here. okay, and C plus D here at a lower enthalpy. So, this pictorially you can show, so this is like an H scale here, okay, this pictorially is delta H R. Okay. So, now you know there is, these are all state properties, this H is just a state property. Now, I will need to know the H of various compounds, and this is where this Hess's law comes in, that for example, I know that C plus O2 can give CO2, and if it is complete burning, it will do this. Okay. And I know that I can measure a delta HR by just measuring how much heat it will do. But C plus O2, of course, I am not balancing any reactions right now, so giving CO, okay, it is very difficult to achieve this very normally, because normally things will burn fully. To get the delta HR of this is difficult, because I cannot, you know, ensure that everything is half, all the carbon is half burned to give me CO. So, I take 1 kg of carbon and I ensure that exactly that 1 kg of carbon. So, for example, I take 1 kg here, okay, I will require some amount of oxygen to burn it exactly to get so much amount of CO. I cannot ensure that in any reaction. So, but when such things are done, then you normally say that you can go for Hess's law, where you say that I can go from C plus O2, this is some enthalpy state, I can go down to C, sorry, CO plus some O2 at some other enthalpy state, and then finally I will get CO2. This delta HR is known. This delta HR is not known, but if I can get hold of some CO and burn with oxygen, then I can get hold of this delta HR. And if you draw this diagram, it becomes pretty obvious to them that if I knew this and this, then these are all just state properties. At this pressure and temperature, the enthalpy was known. At this pressure and temperature, the enthalpy was known. Hence, the delta HR is just the difference. Okay, so you just have to come down so much. Okay, and then you have to come down so much to get to CO2. Okay, so if I know this, if I know this, then definitely I can find out this by just subtracting. Of course, all of this have to be balanced reactions. But then, if you explain to them using this method that this is what is normally done to get hold of certain so-called heat of reactions where you can't easily measure it, then you know you would have given them a good idea of what Hess's law would mean. The question now is: do we really do all this? We use Hess's law, etc., in our calculations? Actually, no. Okay, this is just to give them a background. What normally is done is that you know all these values are tabulated. Okay, so the enthalpy for all various species that are you know available during combustion are just tabulated. Okay, so whether it is carbon, whether it is oxygen, whether it is nitrogen, CO2, H2O, so many things will occur, CH4, C2H6, everything is tabulated as a function of temperature. Okay, and the way this is done is that you first have to find out, okay, or define a datum, and the datum is normally defined is that any element in its naturally occurring form at the standard temperature and pressure, you assign 0 H. Okay, this means oxygen in O2 form, nitrogen in N2 form, carbon in graphite form. So, all elements in their naturally occurring form will be assigned an enthalpy of 0 at 25 degrees centigrade and 1 atmosphere. This is a very standard approach that is adopted by all combustion people, and this is definitely you know way more standard than many other things are standardized. Okay, that you just assign this 0. Now, you say that if I want to form O2, O from O2, then in this case from to go from O2 to 2O, it actually turns out that you will have to provide energy. Okay, this is because some energy is required in breaking that O2 bond. So, if I have assigned an energy to O2 as 0, okay, then H of products minus H of reactants will be a positive number because I have actually provided energy. So, H products will be more. So, let us say I have to give X energy to go to 2O. Okay. So, now what happens is that to get 2O from some 0 state, I have provided X energy, which means that I will assign, if I have formed this O at 25 degrees centigrade and 1 atmosphere, I will say I will assign X by 2 to each O. And I say this is now your enthalpy of formation. And this is 0 to tell you that it is done at 1 atmosphere. So, similarly, I can get, so this HF means enthalpy of formation. So, I will get an enthalpy of formation to get oxygen from some naturally occurring substance, which is O2 molecule. Now, of course, I can get similarly for CO2. I will take C in graphitic state and oxygen occurring naturally, burn it to get CO2 and find out what is the difference in energies here and here. And that I will say is HF of CO2. And thus at 25 degrees centigrade and at 1 atmosphere, I will first tabulate HF0 for everyone. So, this I will do for everything that I think is necessary for me. So, necessary for me would be, you know, O2O, N2N, and this is primarily because I will use air for combustion, and if I have to have oxygen, then so much percentage is already nitrogen. So, nitrogen by default comes in all, you know, combustion calculations. Then, you know, I should be bothered about the most common products, which is CO2 and H2O. Then I should be bothered about all kinds of fuels, common fuels, CH4, C2H6. So, the list is on till maybe I will do it up to diesel, let us say. Okay, I will tabulate all of these, and if you pick up a standard combustion textbook like Terms, okay. Oxygen as O2 molecule at 25 degrees and 1 atmosphere, not oxygen atom. Oxygen atom will not be non, it will be non-zero. That is what I said. Here, if I have given X amount of energy to form 2 oxygen atoms, so let us say I give 100 joules and now I have got 2 oxygen atoms. So, I will say enthalpy of formation of 1 oxygen atom is 50 joules. So, that is I call that as the enthalpy of the oxygen atom, and this is my definition. So, once a set of enthalpy of formations has been tabulated, then I go and say, okay, now you go to the next step where you say, you know, H will actually vary with temperature. So, what should I do? So, then you realize that for each substance, I will need to plot H with T. Here you will realize that if you had some knowledge about, you know, some kind of statistical mechanics, then you will realize that for anything which is monoatomic, okay, a monoatomic gas, okay, the Cp does not change with temperature. Okay. So, if Cp does not change with temperature, then H at any point if I integrate is just integral Cp dt, and since Cp is outside, I can bring it outside if it is constant, then it is just be Cp delta T. So, if I have decided that H is somewhere here, so now of course, mind you know, you will realize that in combustion calculations, at least a ton of quantities will have negative H at 25 degrees. This will happen by default because I have already chosen that something occurring in its naturally occurring state at 25 degrees and 1 atmosphere has 0. So, some law and enough number of compounds will turn out to have a negative H based on this datum. So, let us say I have some H here at 25 degrees. Okay. If I want to measure the h at any point, you will realize if Cp is constant, you will just get a straight line. This is how h will be. If I have diatomic molecules, it will turn out that diatomic molecules will have 6 degrees of freedom, and ideally for 6 degrees of freedom, your final Cp should have been 3R, not just 3 by 2. So, in this case, you realize that Cp will not be a function of temperature, because at room temperature, mostly your only 5 of the modes have already gotten totally completely kicked in, and which means the molecule can translate in any direction and the molecule rotates mostly in all directions, which it is possible. And you will realize only 5 of the modes have really kicked in, and energy corresponding to only those 5 modes have come in, and it will be only 5 by 2 R which has actually kicked in. And to get in the extra mode, which is the vibrational mode, it takes some time, and Cp is not constant. So, if I plot Cp versus temperature, it does not behave constant, but it will behave something like this. So, at a very high temperature, it reaches its correct value. At room temperature, it is a lower value, and somewhere in between, it starts to increase like this. If I have triatomic molecule, CO2, ammonia, then this will no longer look like this, it will look like this. Okay, so, Cp will start having all kinds of shapes beyond the room temperature, and it is by now it is pretty standard in computational chemistry that if I know the structure of the atom, I can know all its vibrational modes, and I can calculate Cp down to the right value even without having done a single experiment, because the quantum mechanical calculations are so good nowadays. So, you take any atom CH4, you give it to a computational chemist, he will tell you what the Cp is as a function of temperature without a problem. So, he will tell, okay, CH4, there are 5 atoms. So, each atom has 3 modes of movement, 5 atoms and 15 modes, 3 translational modes, 3 rotational modes, 6 modes are gone, you are remaining with 9 vibrational modes. He will tell you the frequency for those 9 modes and give you exactly how Cp will vary with temperature. So, this is now that much it has reached the stage, and literally every possible Cp of combustion products are well tabulated. Either you go to Turns book by Turns, or you go to this website by NIST, and you will get this tabulation. Okay, usually the tabulation is done in terms of a polynomial. NIST is National some Standards Institute, it is a US based organization. So, you just say probably NIST.gov, which is a US site, and they will give you the Cp value for everything. So, that is something that you must go check out, tell the students to check out, it is available free. It is a government site, everything is open out there, because it is a standards, it is not a defense site. So, what happens is Cp is normally given as a function of temperature, A0 plus A1T plus A2T squared plus A3T cube plus A4T4. This is the most common format that you will find Cp given. Okay, it is called this 5 constant polynomial format, okay, and this is normally called as the NASA format. Okay, and all this CO2, H2O, CH4, everything, the site will give you A0, A1, A2 up to A4, everything will be given to you. So, this is, if you go to this NIST site, you should get it. So, now if this is given, then if I want H is Cp dT dH, then if I integrate this, you will realize that I will have to integrate it from the 0 condition, which is 25 degrees, to let us say I want some T. Okay. Then here you will realize I will get HT minus H25 is, if I integrate this whole thing, it is A0T plus A1T squared by 2 plus up to A4T5 by 5. This I will get by direct integration. You will realize now you need this other constant, which is your heat of or enthalpy of formation at 25 degrees, and that will give you the 6th constant, which is normally in their terminology given as A5. So, you can again go and check. I am assuming that they are calling it A0, A1, A2, A3, A4, A5. And again, in the most common format that is out there, you will see that this was because the NASA people were worried about lot of reactions occurring, you know, not only in their combustion chamber, but in the re-entry vehicles. And most temperatures are noted up to, most CP data are fitted up to around 3000 or 4000 Kelvin. And you should realize that, you know, whenever I use a combustion chamber, we will come to adiabatic flame temperatures now. The temperatures reach around 2000, 2500 maybe. You know, regular adiabatic, you know, flame temperature, and maybe something higher depending on what the situation is. And people have tabulated all values up to around 3000, 4000. So, this fit, if I use one polynomial fit, that fit does not go the entire range. Okay. So, they split the range, they will give you one set of coefficients from, let us say, 25 degrees to 1500 and then 1500 to 3000. So, two sets of coefficients will be given, and you will always, when you go to the NIST site, find two sets of coefficients, one for the lower range and one for the higher range. So, that is something that you must go there and see. Once this is done, you can calculate the H of any of the compounds that you are interested in at any temperature, okay, because this is all now very standard, this is all standardized, and you can just get. So, if the compound you are interested in is A plus B, you give C plus D. If I want to find out the heat of reaction, find H at 25, B at 25, C at 25, D at 25, get the standard heat of reaction. That is what you do. So, now the next thing that probably people should know is that if I use oxygen, by default I will get nitrogen, and that is because I am using air for combustion. And you know roughly that if I go molar wise, then there is 21% to 79%. Is this correct? Is this some number that people remember? So, if I go volume or mole fraction wise, then if I take air, okay, if I get 21% oxygen, then and there are 79% of nitrogen. So, if I want to write a reaction for burning something, so for example, CH4. Plus O2 gives CO2 plus H2O. Now, I will balance this because first I need. So, there is one C on both sides, C is balanced. There is 4 H here and 2 H here, I will make it 2. So, there are 4 H's now. Then there is one O2 and another O2 here. This. So, there should be at least 4 oxygens on this side. So, probably this is 2. So, is this, I hopefully this is balanced. Okay. So, now if this is balanced, then you will see that if I have used air to burn it, then by default I am getting 79 by 21 times N2. So, how much is that number? It is 3.76, and it is some number which combustion guys just offhand seem to remember, that this is around 3.76. So, for 3.76 into 2, sorry, I should say, because there are 2 moles of oxygen. So, for every mole of oxygen of O2, it corresponds to 3.76 moles of N2, which means it corresponds to 4.76 moles of air, because 3.76 moles of nitrogen and 1 mole of oxygen together will give you 4.76 moles. So, this now has to be drilled into them and, you know, told what is to be expected. Okay. So, this will help them to do combustion calculations, and what probably can be told next is, you know, something about calorific value. Okay. So, if I burn 1 unit quantity of fuel and go for complete combustion, then what is the amount of energy that I release? And this word complete combustion is necessary, because if I start with carbon and go to CO, it is not called complete combustion. So, complete combustion of any hydrocarbon fuel means that all carbon has been converted to CO2 and all hydrogen has been converted to H2O. So, if I need complete combustion, then I will have, let us say, HX and CY as my hydrocarbon. That must go to H2O completely, which means that if I put here, let us say, Z, then twice Z should be equal to X, and I should have, let us say, A times CO2, which means Y should be equal to A if I want to balance. Now, if you calculate how much oxygen is there, oxygen is Z plus twice A. That means if I add here O2, that O2 should be Z plus 2A by 2, because here every one guy has 2 here. So, it is Z plus 2A by 2. And then this much multiplied by Z plus 2A by 2 multiplied by 3.76 times nitrogen will be on this side as well as on this side. So, this is what would occur in complete combustion, and you must find out how much energy is released, and that of course you can find out if you know the H of each species. Now, as I said, all standard H values, delta HR, are at 25 degrees centigrade and 1 atmosphere. That means I must have both my products and reactants at 25 degrees and 1 atmosphere. That means oxygen and nitrogen on both sides will have 0 by definition. Okay, so, what will happen is that there will be some HF for the fuel and some HF for CO2 and H2O separately. Okay, this minus this totally will give me this delta HR at 25 degrees 0. Obviously, this quantity has to be negative if you are using a fuel, because you are releasing the energy and the product should have a lesser H. Now, calorific value is just defined as a negative of this heat of reaction in per unit basis of the fuel. So, if I have, let us say I used this using 1 mole of CH4, okay, then I will get some delta HR. Okay. So, let us say it came out to be 1000 joules. So, this 1000 joules is obtained using 1 mole. So, now normally I will convert into a per kg basis. In the most common. So, I will say if 1 mole of CH4 has so much kg, so 1000 joules was for x. So, let us say this is x kg. Of course, you know x kg is, let us say this is 1 kilo mole. So, this x kg would have been 12 plus 4. So, 16 kgs, let us say gave 1000 joules, then 1 kg would have been just 1000 by 16. And you know that the calorific value of the fuel is just the delta HR by per unit kg, and the kg is the most common unit. Sometimes for gases they will quote it in terms of per meter cube. Okay, this is assuming that you know the gases can be written in that term, that you know it's per meter cube. But per kg is by far the most common way to give your calorific value. So all you are doing is write a balanced reaction, find out the delta HR. Calculate the delta HR, divide it by the, you know, ensure that you calculate it on a per kilo basis and take out the negative value, because if it is a fuel, you better have got a negative value. Remove the negative value, whatever number you get is your calorific value. So, that is something that you will need to explain. Maybe you can tell them, you know, quantities, various quantities which are tabulated for calorific value. So, this is something that you need to do, and finally, I think. Okay, maybe two other things. There is something called as an exhaust gas analysis. Again, I will just take 2 minutes of this. Okay, and what happens is that if I have complete combustion, okay, in the products, if I have a pure hydrocarbon fuel, then in the products I should have only CO2, H2O. And N2, because N2 is not supposed to burn. Okay. So, exhaust gas analysis is important if you have unburned fuel, which means you will have some CO, okay, or if you have some O2, that means you have provided more air than necessary. Okay. So, also again that will come the concept of stoichiometry. this is something that they know for sure. Okay, 11th and 12th standard, they have been told what's a balanced reaction, and hence you must be able to tell them what is stoichiometric air required. So if I just ensure complete combustion of the fuel, then the amount of air required per kg of fuel, okay, on a kilo to kilo basis, will be normally what is called as the stoichiometric air fuel ratio. If I provide more air than required, okay, I will have something called as an excess air, and then, you know, I will call it a lean mixture. And if I have more fuel than required, that is less air than required, I will call it a rich mixture. So this is again something that you can put, and you can maybe this will come again when you are teaching petrol engines or diesel engines, that when should I put in a rich mixture in a petrol engine, when should I put a lean mixture. The diesel engines normally run lean, but this is part of cycle analysis. At the combustion level, you can only need to tell them about, you know, rich and lean mixtures, what is excess air factor, what is stoichiometry. And finally, there is only one concept that probably you need to tell them, which is adiabatic flame temperature. Okay, so this is the last thing that hopefully I will, and then continue on to kinetic theory. So again, I mean, I am not going in detail. If the topic is needed, each of these things will be done in sufficient detail. Okay, calorific value, balancing of reaction, you know, problems using exhaust gas analysis. I mean, if there is so much of exhaust gas, how much excess air did you put, or how much less air did you put? Okay, those are some things that most engineers would need to know, just because you know, it's really necessary in analysis of what kind of combustion you have done. Especially if you are going to power plants and doing combustion, if you can analyze the exhaust gas and tell what is happening, and you know, if something is wrong with the combustion, then you can take care of it. Okay, so the last thing that I said you need to do is what is called as the adiabatic flame temperature. So all this is pretty straightforward. I have H reactants and H products. So I told you that whenever you are calculating heat of reactions, you bring down the products to the standard pressure and temperature, and then calculate what is the heat of reaction. Let's say you didn't do that. Okay, you didn't do that, and let no energy escape from the system. You took a closed system. You did not let any energy escape. So there is no Q, no work was done. Okay, all that is going entirely is getting into the products. Okay, the product's temperature is increasing. Okay, and it reaches a temperature which corresponds to what it should be. That is what is called as adiabatic temperature. So the best way to do this is represent it pictorially. Let's say this is H. Okay, let me go to another page. Okay, this is H, this is T. Okay, now H reactants is, let's say, HA plus HB, where this is some fuel, and let's say this is oxygen plus nitrogen. So I'll just add them up. Okay, so now you should realize that the fuel may be at room temperature, may be at some other temperature. Okay, so if I add this up, obviously each of those three components, that is the fuel, oxygen and nitrogen, they will have certain enthalpy at certain temperature. Let's say at 25 degrees they are here. So I am just putting negative, because it could happen that the fuel has a negative enthalpy at 25 degrees. Okay, oxygen and nitrogen will have zero. Let's say I start here. Then at some other temperature, okay, I will just calculate the enthalpy of each of them. Okay, obviously at a higher temperature the enthalpy will increase. As I go ahead in temperature, I will get another point here, another point here, another point here. So this line, or this curve, it's not a straight line, it's some curve, is the H of reactants as a function of temperature. So that means I have added the individual enthalpies of each, and you know, gotten this curve. Okay, then I know the products. The products would be CO2, let's say H2O and N2. Let's say in this case it's just about complete combustion. If it's not, I will take care of extra oxygen. Okay, again I will plot. Okay, obviously you realize that if I draw it like this, at T is equal to 25 degrees, H products here would start at a lower value. Okay, and this would have been your heat of reaction or enthalpy of reaction. Okay, you go down lower in the enthalpy at 25 degrees, you will start here. Okay, and if I plot or calculate the H of each of these three species, I will get a curve like this. So if I get a curve like this, I need the same, since I take an open system analysis, there is no Q, no W, H should be same on for reactants and products. If H is same, then at the constant H line I draw, I cut this curve somewhere. This temperature corresponding here is what is called as the T adiabatic. Okay. So of course, this is starting at 25. Maybe I have put in air, preheated air and something else. So maybe the H is here. Then I will just draw H constant here, come here, this will be the T adiabatic. So depending on the initial state of the reactant, you will get a different T adiabatic. If I put no more nitrogen in, you will automatically realize that your T adiabatic will go down, because the nitrogen is not contributing to any release of energy, it is just ensuring that its own temperature increases and you know your adiabatic. So if I have, so if you take most common fuels, okay, you will realize that all I need to do is just a balance. I will write H reactants is H products. H reactants, I know the state of each of them. So this, let us say you are given a temperature that, you know, initially it is preheated air at 200 degrees centigrade and fuel is also 200 degrees centigrade. I will use the curve fit, get H of fuel plus H of, you know, O2 and N2, okay, and calculate a number X. Okay. Obviously, this number Y has to be equal to that. This number Y, in, let us say, products are made of only N2, CO2 and H2O. Then H products is just, you know, 25 degrees or whenever you have known it to, up to some T, Cp dT for CO2, same thing for H2O and same thing for N2. Okay. So, what this T is, you do not know. Okay. So, the only thing you know is that if I put in a T, I can integrate up to that T using the polynomial expression and get some value. So, the most common way you have to do this is just go for trial and error. Use a T, calculate the values on the product side and get it. Okay. A lot of times people do not do that, they will do a trial and error, but they will approximately know. So, for most fuels around, okay, the adiabatic frame temperature is somewhere between 2000 and 2200. They will take a guess. Okay, if they take a guess, they will calculate an average Cp rather than, you know, integrating the Cp. Using the average Cp, then I will just say this, because I have calculated the average Cp, for each of these I will just get it as HF plus Cp T adiabatic minus T wherever it began, okay, T 25 degrees. Okay, this is the product side. So, HF for all these species are known at 25, Cp I have already calculated some average value, T 25 I know. So, this will be the only unknown and I will calculate it. Now, I will see if this matches my guessed value. If it does not, I will do another iteration. But roughly you should expect the temperature between 2000 and 2200. If you put excess air, there is more nitrogen, automatically you should know that your adiabatic flame temperature should drop down. It may drop down to 1800, 1600. Anything. If you do not use nitrogen, that means you use highly, you know, enriched oxygen air. So, for example, you use oxyacetylene flame, there is no nitrogen. Okay. So, if there is no nitrogen, then it is not eating up your energy to lower the temperature. In that case, your adiabatic flame temperature will go high. So, for example, in oxyacetylene flames, you can easily achieve more than 3000. Okay. But that is just because nitrogen is playing a role of absorbing the energy and bringing things down. But as long as you explain these concepts and roughly this diagram here of what an adiabatic flame temperature looks like, I think it will give them a good idea of combustion, you know, calorific value, balancing, stoichiometry, air fuel ratio, excess air factor, exhaust gas analysis and adiabatic flame temperature. Of course, I have rushed through this, but this is roughly, you know, something that needs to be covered and probably in far better detail. I would normally take around 3 to 4 lectures when I am teaching this part.